Ari, what's your favorite song from Midnight? Really? I thought you'd like that one.
Collarbone and the rust that grew between telephones, the lips I used to call home so scarlet.
Go. Hi, guys.
Hi, guys. Welcome back.
As you guys know, we've before Midnight's, obviously, we have done a few rankings when it comes to Taylor Swift songs, like her best bridges, best metaphors, best choruses, etc. And as you would have seen in our Midnight's reaction, there were a few songs where we were like, oh my god, this needs to be added to the list.
Mm.
So what we thought we would do today is not necessarily rank some of these Midnight songs against the other songs that we had in those categories, but more discuss which songs we feel from Midnight would have been absolute
contenders
yes, to be on the list that we've already created.
Yeah, we just weren't quite ready to stop talking about Midnight.
No, but we thought this would be a good thing to do before we maybe go into actually breaking down some of these songs for you guys.
Yes.
As you've been asking for, just sort of maybe just slot them into some categories.
Yeah,
so we've done five so far. So they are best bridges, best choruses, best metaphors, best outros, and best pre-choruses. So
yes,
those are the five categories that we will slot some of these Midnight songs into today.
And
just sort of discuss why those parts of these songs are so fucking offensive.
And today's going to be a little bit of a fathoming with you guys, because we actually haven't discussed prior to sitting down in this video. We've kind of gone away and done our own individual fathoming, but
yes,
we have not discussed this with each other yet. So we thought that would be fun to do on camera and kind of just go through the album and be like, oh, this song has an offensive this, this song has an offensive that.
Yes.
And kind of just figure it out in our heads as well, because it's still not something that we've fully come to fathom.
Should we just get straight into it?
Yeah, we should just get straight into
it. Well, the first video that we did was Taylor Swift's best bridges. So I think that we should start with bridges.
I agree.
Take us away. I think we already know what's going to be said first.
I mean, I think that You're On Your Own, Kid is
It's
definitely the top bridge on the album for me personally.
Absolutely.
And I think that we can mostly agree, because it's
absolutely
just, obviously, You're On Your Own, Kid is about her kind of going through her whole career and her whole life, and kind of reflecting on how she's always been doing it alone and how that's just how life is for everyone, really. You always think that someone else is going to save you and is going to make you feel better or this, that, and the other. But actually, it's just up to you.
Yes.
And You're On Your Own, because you have to live with yourself.
I think that You're On Your Own, Kid is one of the songs that we did actually say in our initial reaction to it. Like, oh my God, this bridge needs to have been on the best bridges list.
Yes.
And you're right. Like, everything that you said, I just think that, like, the fact that not only is it another sort of ranty, long bridge, which, you know,
so
is
offensive,
always so loved by her fans, those Jack Rantanoffs. But it's also like the lyrical content about like every sort of one to two lines being like a different phase in her life and like her growing up more and realizing that she's actually going to be okay, but she's also always just been by herself.
Yes.
Absolutely offensive bridge. Should we play it?
I think we should.
I think that we should play it.
And the build up.
It reminds me of Champagne Problems.
It does, yes.
This little musical break between her actually singing the bridge.
Same. Oh my God, and the drums that come in. Repurposing of the chorus, really, isn't it? Because
you know,
that is the chorus every other time.
It's actually something that I've noticed is a really common theme on Midnight's, is that she repurposes either choruses or bridges almost as outros as well.
You're right.
Like this is, this bridge is a repurposed chorus, but it's
also
the outro. And
Yeah, that's true.
That is also true of Would've, Could've, Should've. Mm. The bridge is repurposed as a bit of an outro. And then we've got Sweet Nothing and Labyrinth, which have their like choruses repurposed as an outro as well. It's quite a lot.
With the Would've, Could've, Should've, I think that that's an interesting one because what are we actually considering the bridge there? I don't think it is the God Rest My Soul.
I looked it up.
Is it?
It is considered the bridge.
Uh-huh. Okay, wait, I need to come back to You're on Your Own, Kid, because I've just fathomed from Sprinkle Splashes in all the other bits are pre-choruses.
Yes, actually, you know, I forgot about that. It's like, You're on Your Own, Kid, You Always Have Been is just the chorus.
I think that makes sense because, like, obviously it does feel like you're kind of going into the chorus from Sprinkle Splashes, but from Sprinkler Splashes, You're on Your Own, Kid, You Always Have Been does feel like it's different to that, if that makes sense. Like, I would probably agree with that if I'm looking at it.
You know, it's funny, though, because I don't know if I immediately would have picked, though, that that would be considered a chorus. If anything, I feel like I might have assumed it could have been a little bit of a cardigan in the sense that it's a refrain.
Yeah. Like, I think it does depend on how they want to label it, I think. But also, this is giving Right Where You Left Me.
Yes, because where
the
it's,
pre-chorus
yes.
is that fast pickup where you feel like it's the chorus, but then it's
you're right,
actually
because the chorus is just you left me. You're right. Yes, it's very shortened to the point.
Also, in the sense that the pre-chorus is repurposed as the bridge, but changed.
It's really interesting to see how like each of these songs are technically structured because I think in a song like High Infidelity, it's really obvious that that part that's considered a refrain is a refrain where she says, do you really want to know where I was April 29th and how she continues to change that all the time.
Yeah,
that's obvious to me that that's a refrain.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
But it wasn't obvious to me in something like Cardigan that
Cardigan's
that was
a hard one, but I think when I think about Cardigan it does make sense because it kind of goes like to a different place, I feel. It doesn't feel like it's the peak of the beginning of the chorus. Can I just say then that this really is an offensive song in the sense that I feel like the pre-chorus is obviously extra offensive because it changes each time.
Yes.
And then it gets turned into the bridge. So, yes. You know, this song could almost go into the pre-chorus and the bridge category for that reason. But the bridge is definitely the highlight.
The bridge is the highlight, absolutely.
And look, it's definitely one of my favorite bridges that she's ever done.
Absolutely.
Like, the lyric, I hosted parties and starved my body. Like, I can't believe she gave us that information. Like, obviously, we know that that's something that's been in her past. But I think for her to really confirm that is a very extremely relatable lyric for so many girls. And it's just nice to see that vulnerability from her and also then followed it up by, like, I'd be saved by a perfect kiss. Like, what a relatable sentence for so many girls about the body image and then the kiss, the boy being the thing that
or
girls
just, like,
chase.
Thinking, like, just, I guess, like, to generalize it, it's just, like, that feeling of the way I look is the only way that I will find love and the only way, like, that's where my self-worth is held.
Yeah, is if I find, if I have those two things. And the way that she's dismantling that in this bridge is so powerful.
Absolutely. And I think that that's really the lyric that, like, stopped everybody in their tracks. Like, absolutely. I know for me, like, that when I heard that line in particular, I was like, oh my God, I can't believe that she just said that. It really goes to show that Midnights is really one of her most vulnerable albums to date, and I know we've spoken about this already, just like that the fact that she's really exploring those insecurities and it just makes so much sense that it had to come now.
Another one of my favorite lyrics in this bridge is because there were pages turned with the bridges burned, everything you lose is a step you take. Like, I just feel like she's so perfectly wrapped up how everything, even the hard stuff, is a step forward and it's something that you need to go through in order to grow. And I think it's really nice because sometimes you can look at things, bad things that have happened, bridges burnt and, you know, things that you've lost and think, oh my God, I've lost all of this, it's the end of everything. But it's all part of it. It's all a step that you take forward into this your new self or, you know, your future self.
Yeah, I think that this bridge in particular, like the way that she at the start of it like highlights the insecurities and the hardships that she's faced and then wraps it up with such positivity, like everything will be okay. Like, I think it really highlights exactly why Taylor is as big as she is and why her fans are so dedicated to her, because it just feels like nobody else would write in that same kind of way that makes you feel like her music is going to get you through your own shit. Like,
you go through all the stages in this.
You go
bridge.
Through all the stages.
You go through all so many emotions. In every lyric has a new layer of emotion and actually is processing everything with you because you're feeling the insecurity, you're realizing the effects of it, you're seeing how, you know, you're going through I looked around in a blood-soaked gown, like, no, nothing was there. It was the end of everything for her. And then we build back up, you know, we build back up and we end on this positive note. And it's like, damn, like, you feel like you've processed shit after listening to this.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And the way she ends it with, "You got no reason to be afraid." Like, that is just what everyone needed to hear at the end of that bridge.
I think it's a really so important good. Song for everybody. But also, like, women and young girls in particular, you know, like, it's so inspiring to be able to look at Taylor and the hardships that she's been through and she can, like, give that advice. That's like, you know, whatever it is that you're going through, no matter how bad it gets, like, you will be okay.
Yeah. It's so
I think
nice.
It means a lot to people.
Oh, it does. Anyway, should we move on to our next bridge?
Would've, could've, should've.
Would've, could've, should've.
Would've, could've, should've. Once again, it's a very long bridge. It has a lot of information and insight into the situation that she's singing about, but also the way that she repurposes it as an outro and then changes the melody slightly and, like, you know, uses that, like, higher register of hers to like finish it off at the end as well is absolutely offensive.
I feel like I have an unpopular opinion around this song. I feel like, for me, the bridge is actually not my favorite part of this song, but I think that it still deserves a spot here because I think in general, I think that that's how people feel about this song, that the bridge is the most superior. I actually think, for me, my favorite part of the song is the chorus and the third verse.
That you thought was a bridge?
That I thought was the bridge.
Yeah.
Like, "Give me back my girlhood," it was my verse. Like, I just can't believe that whole lyric and that whole melody, I think, is my favorite part of the song. Let me know what you guys think, because I would be curious to know what your favorite part of this song is. Obviously, it's a fan favorite and everyone loves this song so, so, so much. But is it the bridge, the "God rest my soul" part that you're absolutely dying over? Or are there other parts of the song that you feel like stand out and be the peak? Because I think I think it could be mixed. I think people could think
I think
that
it
the
could
third
be mixed
verse
as well.
Is maybe their favorite part. Because I know that that girlhood lyric is like
a big one
for people.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
I'm like, I wonder. God rest my soul.
Her lyricism in this song and in this bridge is just, I think this is why I'm seeing people compare it to All Too Well or saying it could be even better than All Too Well, because I think that All Too Well has always stood the test of time as being one of her best lyrical songs.
Yeah.
And I think that this song, I can understand why people are comparing the two, because there's a lot there.
The religious motif used throughout the entire song really shines in the bridge. God rest my soul, I miss who I used to be, the tomb won't close, stained glass windows in my mind. Like, I think the stained glass windows is a really interesting lyric, because not only is it giving that church kind of imagery, but I also think the word stained, that feeling of the fact that this is, like, on her still, like, she's still stained by this,
which ties in perfectly with the tomb won't close. It's like, I'm not over this, and I feel like I will never be over this. I also feel like it also works perfectly for the idea that it's like, it's not clear, you know, like, this how she feels about the situation and what the situation was is not actually fully clear to her. It's blurred, it's stained, it's discolored, you know. It's
absolutely.
Like, it, I think it works well for both meanings. Which
so
is
many
why
layers.
It's there's so,
yeah,
but I feel like that about so many lyrics in this song, which is why it's so good.
Oh, you're right.
I
it's
also
very,
think
very, very clever the whole way she's managed to make it work with the religious theme, but also the time.
The intricacy of what she's saying as well, though, and how so much of it feels like to have such a deeper layer of meaning is just
crazy.
I don't understand how she wrote the song.
No.
just to jump back a couple of lines as well, I feel like, you know, I miss who I used to be really ties in well with the I miss my girlhood. Give me back my girlhood. It was mine first.
Absolutely. And then maybe even tying into Bigger Than the Whole Sky if we feel like that they are connected in any way.
Yes, absolutely. And then The Tomb Won't Close, I think, really ties in perfectly with the lyrics in The Great War.
Yes.
Where she says, what lyric is it?
Screaming from the crypt.
Screaming from a crypt, yes, because she's talking about how, like, you know, her past traumas and previous experiences of what are screaming to her to tell her current lover that, you know, blaming him for things he's never done.
Yeah, exactly.
And I feel like the fact that they're both 3 a.m. tracks and the fact that there is that lyrical sort of like the crypt and the tomb, like, I feel like it adds a further context when you listen to those other songs as well, because I just feel like absolutely. It really amplifies, like, not only do we get from this song and this bridge specifically, like, how damaged she feels from this relationship, but then we also see it play out in other songs, how it might be this relationship in particular that has led to the trauma that she's experienced in relationships and, like, how that plays out in current scenarios.
Absolutely. This song is, like, going into the depths of her trauma. And then The Great War is kind of it playing out in her current relationship.
Absolutely.
Why it's causing the problems in this current relationship, which is so clever to give us that context around what is screaming from the crypt? Oh,
yep.
Her past. Uh-huh. Her past, which is this tomb that won't close.
Yes.
Like, what the fuck?
What the fuck? Uh-huh.
I fight with you in
my really
sleep.
I really like the parallel as well with that lyric. Mm. I fight with you in my sleep. I feel like it parallels really well with, like, even the bridge of My Tears Ricochet when she's saying to Scott, and when you can't sleep at night, you'll hear my stolen lullabies, in the sense that I feel like she is in multiple scenarios and in multiple songs really highlighting how these really, like, damaging, traumatizing experiences with people are what keep you up at night and what keep you thinking. And that really is the theme
of
Midnight.
And that's the theme of this Midnight. And then also she says that in, like, other songs as well, like in Antihero when she says, I wake up screaming from dreaming. Mm-hmm. Like, I think there's a lot of lyrics that tie back to the fact that when she sleeps, she's processing a lot of her feelings.
Yes.
She is dreaming a lot of her feelings, and that keeps her up at night.
This is why this whole album theme is so strong and ties in so well with all the lyrics that we've had throughout her entire career of being awake at 2 a.m., 3 a.m., 4 a.m.
Okay.
Do you have another song for Bridges?
I think I do. I think that my next pick would probably be The Great War.
Okay, good, because I had The Great War also on my list.
Okay, great. Because it's really just an offensive bridge. You know what? Maybe
you
should just listen to it.
You know, it's my favorite part of the song.
Yeah.
I think, like, The Great War melodically is
so offensive, right?
Perfect. But this bridge in particular,
she does some things in this
bridge.
Do
you think I can cope? No.
Much to, like, the way that she goes high into this bridge, I think, is a really nice contrast to the rest of the song. Like, it turned into something.
Absolutely.
It really matches the lyric as well. Like, you know, we're getting bigger. Like, something, you know, it turned into something bigger. Somewhere in the haze, I got a sense I'd been betrayed. I think that that's a really cool lyric because, obviously, we know from so many other songs, her talking about her traumas coming back. She'd got a sense she'd been betrayed.
Yeah. I love how that's worded as well.
Yeah.
Because it's actually like her in writing this song, she's worded it in a way it's like, I actually wasn't.
No,
I had a sense
but
I'd
got
been
a
betrayed,
sense,
but
yeah.
I actually had not been
and
betrayed.
And saying in the haze as well, I think, is a really nice tie back to Lavender Haze, where she's talking about, you know, the haze of that kind of love bubble. And somewhere in that haze, I got a sense I'd been betrayed. And then I think following it with that next lyric is also perfect. Your finger on my hairpin trigger, like, the reason she feels like she got that sense of being betrayed is because she's been triggered mm-hmm. about something that he probably has no idea has triggered her because mm-hmm. of her past and yep. her trauma. And it's just such a clever way of wording it. I love that she calls
it a hairpin trigger as well. Same. Because not only does it feel like a bit of a callback to something like right where you left me, but I also feel like a hairpin is something that's very small. You know, it's like she's really highlighting like how
tiny,
small,
her triggers
tiny,
are.
A yeah. comment he might have made or a thing he might have done could have yes. been is enough to just trigger the Great War.
The Great War,
it's
yeah.
like she's really highlighting there, like, just
how
really how damaged
is.
She feels she yeah. is because it's way too easy to trigger
yes,
her.
Yes, totally. And that he might not even realize he's doing it because mm-hmm. it's so small and little. And mm-hmm. your finger on my hairpin trigger, you mm-hmm. know, like he's pushing that button.
Pushing those buttons.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's genius. It's actually just so concerning how she worded that.
But then melodically for her to start that bridge with the it and it and that higher pitch to then go down
soldier
to soldier down on that icy
that's
ground.
That's a completely different melody.
Completely different melody, but the fact that she just goes from high to low so effortlessly is what sounds so offensive.
And she's like almost like picking it up a little bit, like that soldier down that icy ground.
Totally.
Me with honor and truth.
Totally, totally.
And then she changes it again, like broken and blue. Like how she continues that on, I actually... It's too much for my brain.
I love that that's also where the story of this entire song flips a little as well, you know, for her to realize that, like, the words that she uses, like, looked up at me with honor and truth, or even the icy ground,
yes.
it's like icy because she made it
she
that way, and she
it, yeah.
has pummeled him to
yeah,
the ground
yeah, yeah.
with her fighting.
Yeah.
And this poor man just looking up her, looking up at her with
yeah.
honor and truth, and
yeah.
then she finally sees
blue.
That.
Yeah.
And I love that the blue is like wrapping in that
yes.
that color again
oh,
with him that
Joe.
She explored
mm-hmm.
so much during Lover, like
mm-hmm.
relating the color blue to Joe.
Yes.
Perfect. But also the
Which
fact
she
that
does
blue
again and hits different.
Relates to, back to, you know, blue because she's sad because it's the Great War. Blue kind of also
the
reminds
icy.
You of the icy ground.
Yes, it's perfect.
It's all too much.
Impeccable. Impeccable.
So I called off the troops. That was the night I nearly lost you.
Yeah.
I really thought I'd lost you. And yeah, it's just like her finally calming down and realizing that she really doesn't
need
want
to
lose
that.
Him at
no.
all.
And I guess like that war, the whole war imagery throughout this whole song, you know, with the troops as well, is the perfect way to say I called off the troops, which ties back perfectly into her saying like the bombs were close and stuff in
mm-hmm.
in the chorus.
Mm-hmm.
So she's kept that whole war motif throughout this whole with the soldiers as well, like
yes.
Throughout this whole bridge, she loves a good strong, like, I guess metaphor in a way through a lot of these songs with like with would have could have should have, like, and the motif of the religion and
yeah.
then also the war in this song. Like she's done such an amazing job at tying in the themes with every single lyric, and
absolutely.
I feel like the Great War, she does that kind of similarly with the Crimson Clover and just, you know, the whole song
uh-huh.
is so war.
And, you know, on that note, I think that now might be a good time to say that I would also put this into the metaphors category.
Yes.
Yes. Because for me personally, I don't actually know if there would be another song on this album that I think would be close to topping that list of metaphors as well as the Great War does.
To that.
Okay.
Yeah.
About the Great War, about other songs.
Other songs, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love that.
Okay, so that's three bridges on this album that I feel like are just, you know, absolutely superior, offensive,
mm-hmm.
and probably would have made it, definitely would have made it into our bridge category.
Mm-hmm.
Don't tell me what's going because I can't do that.
No.
But is there any other bridge that we want to give an honourable mention to?
I think that Dear Reader deserves an honourable
yeah,
mention.
That's what I was thinking.
For me and Dear Reader, the standout really is the bridge.
I completely agree.
I think it's the highlight of the song. It's the part that I enjoy the most, but
oh,
I also think
God,
that, like, lyrically...
Deeply concerning things in this bridge.
Deeply concerning things. Deeply concerning
Very.
Things.
Very. So wander through these nights, I prefer hiding in plain sight. My fourth drink in my hand, these desperate prayers of a cursed man spilling out to you for free. But darling, darling, please, you wouldn't take my word for it if you knew who was
walking to a house not home alone.
this song really reminds me of Marjorie in the sense that, you know, the verses and the chorus, they're very low key and they also are giving advice in a way.
That was a fucked up thing for you to say. Yeah. You're so right. It's actually very similar, isn't it? Because the verses are just giving advice. Uh-huh. And then the bridge, like, the melody changes and it gets a little bit more information and there's a little bit more going on. You get so much more
context to the song.
Yeah.
It's very, And I was telling Em the other day that I feel like this song is really interesting because, you know, she's obviously giving advice and then saying never take advice from someone who's falling apart.
Yeah.
And I think, first of all, I do feel like the people that tend to give advice and really give a lot of like empathy and like care towards other people's lives are usually the people that are breaking down themselves, and the way that they mask that is by helping other people or like kind of talking about other people's lives and giving them advice.
Yes. And it also makes sense as well because the ones who are going through it the most are also the ones who are thinking about this stuff the most. So then when other people are going through it, they're like, well, I've been thinking about this and this is how I could help you kind of thing. Like, it does and make a lot of sense. It makes them
feel better as well in a way, helping other people when they're kind of going, collapsing. And Taylor gives us that throughout each chorus. She's like, you know, never take advice from someone who's falling apart. But then the bridge is really how she tells us how she's falling apart. So it's the first time that she goes, I wander through these nights, you know, like, this is what's going on for her. This is why you shouldn't take advice from her. Why she thinks that you shouldn't take advice from her. And it's extremely vulnerable, kind of just opening up again why she's falling apart. Mm-hmm. And I think that it's a very clever song in the sense that we kind of wait to that bridge to really understand the context of what she's saying to us.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You're so right. We do get all of the context of how she's falling apart in this bridge. It's really quite offensive.
We really love that, don't we? So I wander through these nights. I prefer hiding in plain sight. That's concerning. Taylor Swift wandering around hiding in plain sight.
It's very concerning. And I think as well, like, for so long, since pretty much Reputation, it feels like we've gotten, like,
we've never seen
we could count in our hands how many paparazzi pictures we have of her, right?
Yeah.
Like, it just feels like she is constantly hiding, but we think she's hiding indoors.
Yeah, and maybe she's hiding this in plain sight. This is such a lot for her to say. Yeah, maybe she's out more at nighttime and at midnight.
Well, it does make sense, like, I wander through these nights. I prefer hiding in plain sight. Like, love a little night walk for you, doll.
Yeah, do some night walks, doll.
It also kind of does remind me of songs like Delicate and stuff, where it's like, you know, obviously she was going to like dive bars.
Yeah, I think she means by, obviously, my fourth drink in my hand, these desperate prayers of a cursed man. See, it did remind me of that lyric, pouring out my heart to a stranger, but I didn't pour the whiskey.
I think what's important about this lyric is that it actually needs to flow on with the next line, spilling out to you for free. Like, I think that the way that I've always taken it is like, this is her spilling her most, all of that vulnerability and all her hardships out to us.
Yes.
In a way?
Yes. I'm confused why it says desperate prayers of a cursed man.
Well, I don't think that man is meant to be taken literally like a male. I think it's meant to be taken humans. Like we're all, human.
Yeah. Desperate prayers, like her desperate prayers. She is the cursed man.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Desperate prayers of a cursed man spilling out to you for free.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. You wouldn't take my word for it if you knew who was talking. So once again, you wouldn't take advice from me if you knew how broken I was.
Yes.
If you knew where I was walking. I love how the melody changes there as well. Like, it almost slows down and gives us like this space in the bridge. Because the first part's quite fast. I wander through these nights. I prefer hiding in plain sight. Like, it's all quite fast. And then, if you knew where I was walking. And then it speeds up again to a house, not home. Alone, because nobody's there.
Sorry. Yes, no, yes. It kind of like picks up a new kind of fast pace there as
it's
well.
It's all different.
Which is different to the beginning as well. So which is what makes this bridge so offensive.
Yeah.
Is all of those changes in the melody.
Absolutely.
Really keep it very interesting.
And the tea that lyric spills as well. To a house, not a home. All alone because nobody's there.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's also really telling of, like, what was happening during Midnight's era, because we knew that, when she was writing anyway, we knew that Joe was away filming.
Yeah.
And so maybe, you know, this was a night after she'd been recording with mm-hmm. Jack, and she's had some drinks and she's wandering home and she's like, fuck, like sometimes I just feel like I've got no one.
Mm-hmm.
I do think
it could also be like, I feel like the rest of the song in a lot of ways does kind of refer back to that Reputation era as yeah. well. So I also feel like in some context it could be like maybe a representation of how she was feeling at that time as well.
Yeah.
Especially with the next lyrics, where I pace in my pen and my friends frown, friends who care. Because yeah. I do feel like that's when she kind of like didn't really have the squad anymore.
Totally.
And, you know, she really like got rid of some of those friendships that she was really open about during that 1989 era.
Yeah, you're right. It is interesting because I do feel like this could be reflecting on the Reputation era. I feel like for me, I've always taken it as it is more of a current feeling that she's having, but on her down days, if that makes sense.
Because yes.
obviously her life is good and everything, and you know, she has a lot of good in her life, but I think she still has those days where she feels like she's falling apart, and it's like almost like a peep into those nights where she feels like my friends found friends who care, like maybe even her friends from home and stuff, where she can't
yep.
be friends with them anymore because she's
yep.
Taylor Swift. Like
yeah.
it's almost like it feels like this is like those moments where she feels like her fame is so big,
yeah.
which is very, like, very big theme on this album,
yeah.
that she can't be normal. No one yep. sees when you lose when you're playing solitaire. And I feel like that lyric wraps it up for me because it's like no one is on her level.
Yeah.
No one else gets it. She
and
is
it also ties in well with
no
You're on Your
does.
Own Kid as
yeah.
well. It's just like this bridge really amplifies like that meaning of like her really realizing that she is alone in this,
yeah.
whether it just be like how she feels day to day on like a human level,
yes,
or
yes.
how
or
she
in
feels
fame.
In her fame.
Yeah.
And
I think everyone can still relate to that lyric as well. Cause yeah, like it, sometimes it does feel like you're playing at this game yourself that
mm-hmm.
no one else is a part of because mm-hmm. no one else is in your life. No one else
yes.
is in your body, in your mind. Anyway, dear reader, Offensive Bridge.
Offensive Bridge.
Song.
That's all that I wanted to touch on in terms of the bridge. The only
there
other
are,
one that I would maybe bring up is Mastermind.
Ah.
And I think that that's just because I think that people really love the lyrics in the bridge with like, no one wanted to play with me
yeah,
as a little kid, and
I
really get the context of like why
yeah.
she felt like she needed to be like scheming and, you
I
know,
think
the
my
mastermind.
My favorite part of that song is when she builds back out of the bridge being like, I'm only,
yeah, that whole part.
Cryptic and Machiavellian, cause I care. That's like
yeah.
one of my favorite parts of
yes,
that song.
Yes.
But then also, you know, I really love the Snow on the Beach bridge as well. Like with
same.
Now I'm all for you, like Janet. Can this be a real thing? Can it? I love the bridge of Snow
absolutely.
On the Beach.
And let's be honest, we could mention so many songs
yeah,
in these categories, but I guess the point is that we're trying to be like, what ones could maybe make it to the list we've already
yeah,
created?
Yeah.
And I do think that the ones that we've mentioned initially, You're On Your Own Kid, Would Have, Could Have, Should Have, and The Great War are really the standouts. I think that next I would like to go to metaphors because
oh,
I just want to know what you have to say. Because as I said earlier, like, I think for me, like, the one that I do really feel could be close to topping a metaphor list on this album would be The Great War and The Great War Only. And
okay,
I do
so
agree.
So interesting. I have two that have immediately popped into my head.
Okay, outside of The Great War?
Yeah.
Okay, please tell me.
Well, first of all, Snow on the Beach.
Okay, yes, that's a good metaphor.
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously
you're right.
her saying that, you know, snow on the beach is this really amazing kind of phenomenon that would maybe happen and it would be really fucking weird but really fucking beautiful. And that is kind of her, the metaphor for that is like falling in love with someone at the same time that they're falling in love with
yes.
you and this kind of magic that
mm-hmm.
it is, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I think the snow on the beach metaphor is a really, really powerful one.
You're very, very right. I think for me, The Great War stands out because I think that that war metaphor is consistent throughout the whole song.
I agree.
But I also know that there were a lot of songs that we brought up in our metaphor list that didn't, that they weren't necessarily, the metaphor wasn't necessarily carried throughout the entire song, which Snow on the Beach fits that really well.
I think with The Great War, I think for me, it's a more obvious metaphor, kind
yes.
of like something like,
Getaway Car.
Well, no, actually, I think even something like Clean.
Yeah,
like,
okay.
I think Getaway Car is a really kind of not an obvious metaphor to use for a rebound or getting away from someone.
Yeah.
Whereas I feel like the Great War, like,
and a fight in a relationship, you can, yeah.
Yeah, like, we're having a fight. It's not an actual war, yeah, as in the sense of, like, you know, there are people and soldiers and bombs and killing. Yeah. So, yes, she has taken that metaphor to another level with the, yeah, actual war imagery, but a fight is still, like, a fight, whereas, like...
A fight is a fight. Yeah, I get that.
A fight
that.
Is a fight, whereas, like, that. Falling in love with someone, I would never have thought
to relate it to snow on the beach.
The metaphor of snow on the beach. Like, I think, yeah, that's a very, very clever, yeah, unpredictable metaphor. But then also, I think that maroon is a metaphor song.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's a metaphor kind of like red, but maybe,
yeah,
not.
I was going to say, I think it's but kind of a metaphor in the same way that red is.
Maybe things were actually just maroon. So maybe it's not a metaphor. You know, the what burgundy on my t-shirt, when you splash your wine into me, like, it was maroon.
Yeah.
You know, the blood rush into my cheeks, it was maroon. Maybe it's not actually a metaphor.
It's just very, yeah, straightforward.
Yeah, it's, maybe, yeah, it's, I just get that. Like, maybe she's,
and
just,
I guess,
attaching
that red
a
can
color.
Some extent fall into that category as well. Because, well, it's like, red does evoke those feelings of, like, passion and,
yeah,
love,
see,
and all
red's,
of that. So.
Yeah, red's actually feels different to me, because red feels like, yeah, she's more talking about it was red, not actually that there was anything physically red in the room or in the space.
Sure.
It was like the feeling was red because the red, the color red actually evokes the emotions, the passion,
yeah,
and the love, whereas maroon actually maybe doesn't do that.
No,
as much.
I think that,
do you know what I mean?
I think
I'm
that,
having a moment. I'm fathoming. I'm,
yeah,
fathoming.
No, I get what you're saying, definitely, about how it could be or not be.
Mm.
But I do think that, like, generally speaking, when we discuss maroon and we try to fathom it, I think that, you know, what we consistently come back to is that maroon feels like an older, darker red.
Yeah.
And we do feel like there is a connection between,
yeah,
red, the song, the album, and maroon, having been that time has passed, and so maybe that red color has tinged. And I think that when you look at it from that perspective, it does fit more into the metaphorical,
yeah,
category.
Yeah. It's a hard one, isn't it? Oh my god, I just thought of another one.
What?
Midnight Rain.
Yeah, Midnight Rain's a good one.
All
too.
Of me change like midnight rain.
Yes, yes.
So
yes,
I think,
yes,
that song really deeply fucked me up when I first heard how she was using the words midnight rain, because I was really not expecting her to use
be the
it
midnight
as a
rain.
Descriptive word for herself.
No, not at all.
Or a metaphor for herself.
No, I could not have fathomed that either. When we heard the title,
yeah,
track Midnight Rain without hearing the song, never in a million years did I think that she would be the midnight rain.
Yeah.
But you're right. He was sunshine.
I was
midnight rain. Is really like a metaphor for how polar opposite they were,
totally,
from each other, and maybe why that relationship couldn't have worked.
And I think what she's also saying in that song is that to her, midnight rain is complex. It's dark. It,
yeah,
has a lot of emotions. It,
yeah,
changes. It's unpredictable. It's got depth.
Yeah.
And I think that that's what she's saying there when she says, I am midnight rain. I change like midnight rain.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of, I think, layers to that meaning of what midnight rain is to her.
Mm-hmm.
And I,
mm-hmm,
think,
I'd really love for her to talk about midnight
about,
rain a little bit,
yeah,
more.
Yeah, me too.
Like, I'd love to know, like, what her insight is as to, like, what the words midnight rain mean to her in relation to herself.
Yeah. Okay, what should we do next?
I say let's maybe do...
Should we do Fathom pre-choruses?
We
I
could
don't
do,
know
yes.
if I have fathomed all of them. Slash,
okay,
what
well,
my favourites are. Can you want to present us?
I definitely have a presentation for pre-chorus.
Tell us.
What topped my list was actually Anti-Hero.
Yes!
And
I did think about this one.
I think what,
yeah,
I love about the Anti-Hero pre-chorus is... Not only is the melody really great, but it changes both times as well.
Should not be left to my own devices. They come with prices and vices. I end up in crisis. Sailors all this time. I wake up screaming from dreaming. One day I'll watch as you're leaving. Cause you got tired of my scheming. For the last time.
Oh, offensive. offensive.
Offensive.
I love these pre-choruses, yes, because the melody is amazing. She's obviously really throwing some bars there with her rhymes and her,
yes.
her crisis and prices and vices. Like, yes. But also I think it's such a vulnerable, really amazing lyric as well. Like, and what then dreaming, leaving, scheming as well.
Yeah. But then in the second one, narcissism, congressman, yes. Like, you know, she's able to actually like somehow use multiple words that actually rhyme very, very well together.
Did you hear my covert narcissism, like disguises, altruism, like some kind of congressman?
I think that what I love about the pre-choruses as well is that like the whole song is obviously exploring her own like insecurities, and I feel like it kind of makes me feel like what she really feels like she can live for is her relationship and Joe in particular, and like it's the idea that him leaving is just the worst thing that could ever happen to her.
Like, I think this song could be totally taken as things that come up in her relationship, but also her relationship with the media and fame and stuff, especially because at the end of the chorus, she says, you know, it must be exhausting always rooting for the anti-hero. And sometimes I think she's maybe talking to her fans in that way. Like,
yeah.
You guys have always got my back and you're always rooting for me, but I actually feel like I've got all these really problematic flaws and things that it must be exhausting having to always have my back.
I think that the overarching theme of the song really is her being like, how can you guys actually deal with me?
Yeah, I think the pre-choruses really give us context around the entire song. I think it's my favorite part of the song to listen to. I mean, I do love the verses as well. The melodies are offensive.
They are.
But the pre-choruses are so fun.
They're so fun.
So fun. They give us so much.
And once again,
tea.
I just love that they change. I love that she changes them both times as well. That is actually, for me, on this album, the one pre-chorus that I feel could be a contender for the pre-chorus list.
Yes, I would probably agree.
In my exploration, I wanted to say question when I was having a look. I realized that technically the part that I thought was a pre-chorus is actually part of the verse. So it can't really be used.
I think I have something slightly offensive to say, and that is I'm pretty sure I'm So In Love is a pre-chorus in Paris.
I think you might be right, like, because like we were in Paris is just the
it
chorus.
Is, yeah.
Absolutely then.
That is an offense.
Paris absolutely needs to be on the pre-chorus list. Yeah.
Is a superior pre-chorus.
That's the best part of the song.
Yeah.
Yes.
Lavender Haze also has a pre-chorus where she says the whole, I've been under scrutiny, yeah, oh yeah.
Yeah, beautifully.
But I don't think that makes the cut.
No, I don't think that that's my favorite part of the song.
No, I agree. Midnights is not a pre-chorus album.
It's not.
No.
It was Reputation that topped that list, wasn't
it?
Yeah. Reputation has a lot of pre-choruses.
A lot of pre-choruses, and I think there are a few Evermore ones on there as well.
Yes.
What is next?
I think we should do choruses.
Choruses.
Next.
I'm scared about this one.
Oh, I have a couple.
Okay.
I have
what
couple,
do you want to start us
well,
off
Well, I was thinking about it because, you know, obviously there is a lot of offensive choruses on this album.
A lot.
But I was like, you know, like you can't just sit here and list like every fucking chorus. I'm
no.
like, which ones do I actually like love so much that the chorus is my favorite part of the song and that I actually think would maybe be in a top 15, top 10 choruses of all time.
Mm-hmm.
For me, one of them is Maroon.
Yeah, I agree. I completely agree.
Like,
that
I think
the
that,
that
everybody is offended by the chorus of Maroon, particularly the second half of it, where she lists all of those things that are the color maroon or like a ready color. Nobody's well. Nobody's well.
And then the fact that she ends the outro also with the chorus, like, in the lower...
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
Look, that could be contender for best outro.
But you're right. Like, the fact that she uses, like, her lower register to repeat that second half of the chorus as an outro is fucking insulting.
No,
like,
it's so
how
insulting.
How dare she do that? The rattling off of all of those things that have that maroon ready color is too much.
And one of our favorite things about that chorus as well is the fact that in the second one she changes the way she sings T-shirt and collarbone. Yes. And the
it's like
way
she's kind of adding some ad libs in there, yeah, like over t-shirt, the top of it,
yeah,
that just amplify it.
And, the way
and that's
she
what's
says,
so special
was,
about the chorus was. In this song as well is that it does feel like it. She changes how she sings it every single time.
Yes, you're right.
Which amplifies how good this chorus is.
Or the way she changes how she's singing is so offensive. And then, yeah, dropping down at the end, like, you're right, there's always something new and slightly fresh about the chorus each every time we listen yes. to it. What so, do you think your favorite lyric is in the chorus? I think that mine might be the rust that grew between telephones, the lips I used to call home.
I was going
to
say the same
really?
Thing.
Really?
Yeah, I was.
It's just the rust yeah. that grew between telephones is the most offensive way of saying that we don't talk anymore. Like,
how dare she do that?
I actually can't handle it. The lips I used to call home, no, so, so, so illegal.
So illegal. Do you have a chorus contender?
I mean, how does one go past the car chorus?
That was my second
okay,
one.
Okay, good.
That was my second one. The Karma chorus is so
good. It's so good.
Oh my god.
Maybe claim the breakdown in that as well, because it technically is the chorus that she's kind of redoing.
See, breakdowns are another category that you can't really rank. There's not enough breakdowns in
Taylor's discography. That's why I feel like it's fair to claim it, because it is the chorus change, if that makes sense. You know,
yeah.
like if the breakdown is the pre-chorus, then it kind of adds to the pre-chorus category. Or if it's the bridge, it adds to the bridge category.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Because the fact that we go into Karma is the thunder rattling around, and then we go back into Karma is my boyfriend, the two ways of contrasting the karma there is in the chorus. And I think that that is just so genius that this is a sparkly, happy, glittery song.
Yes.
With a moment of being like, oh no, but this is your bad karma.
Yeah, totally. And then
all of my good karma.
Totally. And then the actual chorus is like, all my good karma.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, I think that something that we also were keeping in mind when we made all of these lists as well is like, you know, which ones would we all mostly agree are her best, you know, whatever. And then, like, I guess we reserve the honorable mentions for, like, our favorites in particular.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And Karma's a tricky one because I think that most people would have to agree that Maroon is one of the best choruses she's ever written. I don't know yet if people would consider Karma one of the best choruses she's ever written. And the reason that I say that is because I actually feel like just after Midnights came out, like, everyone was like, what the fuck do you mean Karma is my boyfriend or Karma is a cat? Like, people were kind of hating on the lyrics.
Yeah.
And so I think for that reason, I'm like, do people actually think this is one of her best choruses? I don't know.
I think that people that hated on those lyrics, like, if I'm being honest, like, you're taking yourself a bit too seriously. Like, this song is genius because of the way she's, like, it's part of its genius, if that makes sense. Like, the fact that she's saying Karma is a cat purring in my lap because it loves me, like, it's funny. It's meant to be silly. It's fun. It's a glitter gel pen song. If you don't appreciate Taylor's glitter gel pen songs, you don't deserve her quill pen songs, in my opinion.
No, I completely agree. It is meant to be fun. She is trying to be funny.
Absolutely.
And I think that, like, if you think it's cringe, like, that's on you.
Like, what part of this song is cringe? Like, all I see is genius. Like,
absolutely.
I'm just like, have you heard the melody? Like, I'm so sorry. Like, no one can come up with a song that catchy.
This is one of the best bops I've ever heard.
It's the best bop I've ever heard.
Absolutely.
I would go as far as saying this chorus does something to the soul.
Absolutely.
That is indescribable.
Yep.
It's magic. No idea how she wrote that chorus. It's just so fun. And
it also, though, is like, in her describing her good karma in this chorus, I actually think in a lot of ways it's really quite literal. Like, it's not meant to be cringe.
No.
She's literally like, the fact, like, my good karma is represented in, I found the love of my life.
Yeah.
I fucking love cats. Yeah. And they love me.
And I have a great time with them.
And I have a great time with them.
The wind in my hair, you know, it's having like, fun on the weekends. Like,
100%, like, my, I am happy with all of these things that I have in my life.
Yeah.
And these things are representative of the good karma that I have, because if I was a shitty person and I had bad karma, I wouldn't have these things.
Exactly.
Like, I think that if I was to have an honorable mention in this category, for me, it would be Question. But once again, I don't think that, like, the general fandom would necessarily agree with that. I just love it because it's long, and I love the like, and how she changes that melody halfway through the chorus as well. I love that. Should we do outros?
Yes, outros.
Now, wow. I've got a few. Yeah, I've got a few on this list. Would you like to go first?
Well, I think that the first and top one for me would be Bejeweled.
Yes.
Same.
Yeah. I have that on the list as well. Yeah. Uh-huh.
I think that, I mean, look, let's just play it. Yes. It's a little quick nugget, but the reason it's so offensive is because she's kind of repurposing the bridge.
Yeah, she is. Repurposing the bridge, which is offensive. It's also just so playful and fun, and it's just such a unique way, I think, to end the song as well.
It's a really nice way to kind of change up, like, the rhythm of what we've been used, how she's been singing parts of the song, because, like, it is the bridge repurposed with, like, a slightly different thing to it. Obviously, when she does the "What's a girl gonna do? A diamond's gotta shine" in the bridge, and then the outro, she's just like, "What's a girl gonna do? What's a girl gonna do? I polish up nice," which is different as well, because, you know, before she says, "I polish up real nice." So, yeah. She's changed the way she's singing it, and that's just not obvious to me. I love it. It definitely, like, it just satisfies my brain so much when she re-says something slightly differently, in a way that is, you know, different to how she's previously said it, because I love that she's just thinking about it in a different way and making it work, and it's satisfying. There's something about it I that's
think it's
so
just
fun.
It's just such a new unique way for her to end the song, like, I think that it's not obvious, like, very, you know, there are songs where sometimes she'll just end with the bridge or end with the chorus, and, like, you know, I think that there's absolutely a place for that, and she always knows what to do best, but I think that Bejeweled is like, I can't think of another way that would have been appropriate to end that song.
Yeah, I agree.
And so for her to, as you say, like, repurpose that bridge, I just think it's just really creative, and I love it. I love it. It's one of my favorite parts of the song is how she ends it.
I love looking forward to that. Sometimes it just makes all the difference with a song when you have that slight little change up at the end.
Absolutely.
What else do you have on this list?
Well, I am going to mention two at the same time.
Okay.
For a reason.
Yeah.
Two of my other favorite outros on this album and my favorite parts of both of these songs are Sweet Nothing and Labyrinth. And the reason that I'm bringing them both up at the same time is because both of them are just, in a sense, a repetition of the chorus used as an outro. But both of them have entirely different production behind them, which makes it seem very different from it just being the chorus.
Absolutely. I'll go to the second chorus. Uh-huh. Yeah, and then in the last one. I still feel like that's the last chorus, you know? It's not the outro.
But
even
it is the outro.
It is the outro.
Yeah.
But it's not...
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. It isn't when you said Sweet Nothing and I was like, oh my God, it's because I was thinking about the piano remix, which a lot of you guys probably haven't heard, but they actually changed the outro in the piano remix.
Yeah.
And it has, like, this whole piano moment that comes in.
Yes. And that violin.
Absolutely rude. Beautiful Piano, one of my favorite
Beautiful Piano
outros. Anyway, we really struggled to pick an outro. Labyrinth feels like the outro is a real moment, particularly because the production actually does drop that beat in. So mm-hmm. I feel like it feels like a completely separate part of the song.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, Labyrinth would be like number one if we could include that drop
as an outro. Yeah,
the drop of the beat coming in there, because like obviously it's just a completely new sound that we haven't heard. Uh-huh. Her and Jack are just doing the most offensive sounds there. You're right, she repeats a very particular part of the song, which is that
the pre-chorus.
You know how much I hate, but then she just stops there and yeah. it goes, you know how much I hate.
Yeah.
Which I find a very, just a very interesting choice and a very not obvious choice. She's uh-huh. not even repeating a full lyric. She's kind of cutting it off and then looping it.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is super interesting that she does that.
I think that that's why for me it feels like an outro as well, just because like it's unique. Like she's taken a part of the song that was there previously and repurposed it to yeah. fit this new part of the song that helps wrap it up.
Absolutely.
A little.
I agree.
Well, to bring up another outro that is one of my favorites, that is actually an outro.
Mm-hmm.
Another one that I would say is Snow on the Beach, because I just love that whole part where they're singing, it's coming down, it's coming down, it's coming down, it's coming down. That's offensive!
Completely
and
agree.
That was a real standout to me the first time that I heard the song as well. Like, I loved how that was sung specifically.
It feels like it's actually coming down, her vocals. Gosh, isn't it?
It is. That's offensive. It's like, I don't know if generally people would agree that it's one of the best outros, or even if like I agree with that.
Yeah.
But I love it.
It's like, definitely an
just
offensive.
Just to bring attention to that outro. It's...
Yeah, I agree. It is hard to rank them against like the ones we've already have ranked, but just to like, I guess just to even fathom what are the top ones on this album. Oh my God, I'm so sorry. I just thought of my favorite one.
Midnight Rain.
Yeah.
But then did is you have that also an outro as well?
Yeah, it's considered an outro.
So it's not a bridge.
No.
That's interesting.
I know. Sometimes we all get some kind of haunted, some kind of haunted.
Like the whole, and I never think of him and he never thinks of me. Like, I don't think lyrically is that special.
Yeah, see, I actually really love that part of the song. Mm. I think that, yeah, like maybe it's not my favorite part of the song. But then again, like, I think it's a very, very special outro.
It
like,
is.
I think it's super unique the yeah. way that she ended it. I think it's so offensive that she ended it by being like, you know, because it's called Midnight Rain and these are midnights through her life, I think the fact that she ended it by saying, like, and he never thinks of me except for when I'm on TV and I never think of him except for midnights like this.
Yeah.
I think it makes for one of the core songs on this album for me in terms of the theme and in terms of, like, the way that she's reflecting on these past relationships and then kind of tying it back into being like, I only think about it on midnights like this.
Yeah.
I think for me that makes it like a really special lyric.
Mm.
And I really look forward to that part in the song.
I think that if we're going by what is technically considered an outro
yeah.
and what I love the most out of the ones that we can actually call that, it's Bejeweled.
Yeah. I completely understand. And, mm-hmm. you know, we'll just put a sneaky little, obviously Labyrinth is in there.
Obviously Labyrinth is in there.
Because that is the highlight of the song for me.
Absolutely.
I just have to give one more honorable mention to the outro of Lavender Haze, because she does this bit.
Oh, yes.
I just wanna stay and I'm living the haze. bit of a absolutely moment in the sense that she, you know, repeats one lyric from the bridge, but then she also gives us that new kind of little melody and that note there. It's just so satisfying and soothing and lovely. Look, Lavender Haze has lots of little tiny moments that I'm like, that's the best thing I've ever heard.
Yes.
But as a song, as a whole, like, I can't be like, you're the best song I've ever heard, but even if you kind of are. So
but then once again, isn't that interesting? Because it's like, I feel like that's happened so many times on this, like, as we've been ranking these songs. Yeah. Like, so many of the songs that have been on these lists are not my favorite songs overall, but they, without a doubt, have parts of those songs of that you can't deny. Anyways, that was fun.
That was fun.
It's interesting to, as you're fathoming new songs, like, kind of separate them into categories like this, because I think that in trying to do so, you really get to know the different parts of the song and, like, really understand what parts what, and
get to appreciate. I don't know
what it is, like, I think it's something that, like, some people probably don't care about to like break down a song like that at all, but I find it so interesting to know how the song is structured and, like, which part is which. I love doing this.
It definitely just adds to the appreciation, doesn't it, when you understand that she's doing these little sneaky things and tricks.
It can help you understand the genius of it.
It helps you understand the genius of it more, because especially, like, even like with the refrain in High Infidelity and how she flips those two sentences. That is just a concerning thing for me, because I'm like, how does she come up with that?
Best thing on the whole album. Yeah. But, like, I can't even, like, what am I supposed to do with that? I can't rank it anywhere.
Oh my God. Well, hopefully this helped you guys fathom the songs a little bit more.
Yeah.
And you got some more out of this. Please let us know your favorite parts of the songs down below. Yes. Anything that maybe we haven't fathomed yet.
Yes.
Would love to discuss. And obviously we'll go into great detail into each and every one of these songs when we do the breakdown.
But
hopefully you enjoyed this.
Yes.
Just some further fathoming of Midnight.
Just some further fathoming.
Love to see it.
There's always much fathoming to be done with a new album. Mm-hmm. And breaking it down this way, obviously, as we said, it helps us all understand her genius and how she can somehow write songs in completely new ways that aren't just like that typical kind of structure, and that's why it's so fun to think about this kind of stuff.
Structures are so fun.
It's so fun.
It just keeps the song so interesting and fun to listen to.
Yes.
And some of the things that we mentioned today are the reason I feel like give songs higher repeat value, if that makes sense.
Yes.
You just want to listen to it more and more and more.
You're always getting something new.
Because it's so interesting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Anyways, thank you so much for watching. We'll see you in another video soon.
Yeah, what is the next video? You know what? It might be a little reaction to something new and fun and different.
It might be.
Yeah.
You know? We'll just have to wait and see.
Love you guys so much. Thanks for being here. See you later.
Bye.